The date today is 2/8/93, and we're here to talk to Edna Bloomdahl, who has been a lifelong resident of White Lake and Whitehall, and she knows a lot about Sylvan Beach. Edna, can you tell us what your first memories were of White Lake?
Of course, I'm not a lifelong resident. I came here from Chicago.
Oh, I see.
In 1921. That's all right. This, I think everyone should know
that, yes.
That I did come here. But when I came here because my father was quite ill, and we came to Michigan for his health. And
what was he ill with?
Well, possibly just normal types of things, which he recovered from very quickly after we got to Michigan.
Well, the health trip seemed to do some good then.
Yeah, that's right. But we had been coming to Michigan for many years before we decided to come to Michigan to live. Because we used to come up on the Alabama and the Muskegon. And then from Muskegon, we went out to Lakewood, where we were at the Lakewood Resort for a while.
Did you take a car out to the Lakewood Resort?
Oh, no. You took the train from right downtown, where the train station is in Muskegon. You took the train down to Lakewood Station. And at Lakewood Station, a man out there met you with his old truck and took you the balance of the way. And then later on, there was a streetcar in Lakewood.
Wow.
That took us around. And of course, this was done by a lot of people who were big promotioners, big developers in those days. They were here then just as well as they are now.
A class of people that have always stayed with us.
At the first years, we stayed in what was a small tent with very few modern facilities. Then later on, my father built a small cottage in Lakewood. And after we'd been in Lakewood for a while, we decided to move into Muskegon. So we lived in Muskegon for maybe a year and a half.
Okay.
And I went to Bissell Business College while I was there. And my father evidently was feeling so good, he felt he had to get into business again. And having been in the grocery business, he was traveling up to Whitehall by train from Muskegon. Yeah. And became acquainted with Mr. Shellhammer, who had the White Lake Grocery.
Just real off the cuff, quick, do you happen to remember what the train fare was?
No, I have no idea. I know those train fares were so small, though, just like it was when you traveled on the boat.
Uh-huh.
The same thing. I mean, I wonder now, where did we get the money for that? But we met, it wasn't very much.
Yeah, it came from somewhere.
No, yeah, no, that's right. And I'm sure back in the records you could find out how very little. You possibly might have even just spent less than a dollar to come from Muskegon to Lakewood, or from Muskegon to Whitehall, as whatever the case might be.
Mm-hmm.
So, but anyway, we were then from Muskegon. My father bought the White Lake Grocery. And we came to Whitehall. And for quite a little while, we traveled back and forth by car from Muskegon to Whitehall to run the store.
I'll be.
Yeah, and of course, after all, those were the days of the narrow roads.
yeah, not exactly superhighways.
Yeah, that's right. So,
Where was your store located in Whitehall?
Right where Gales.
Oh, Gales.
Where Gales is, and of course, Pitkin's Drugstore right next to us.
I'll be darned.
Yeah. And my father was there for quite a while. And it was during that era period that he took over the grocery side of the arcade.
Okay, during
yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, about 1921, then we're talking.
Well, no, we're possibly up to about 1924.
Okay.
When he took over the arcade down there, and that was just the grocery side.
Okay.
And of course, the arcade, which I hope everyone knows what that arcade was, that it was like a two-story building with a tunnel through it. It's hard to explain that building.
You know it is. People have explained it to me many times.
Yeah, but as you would go in from what is now the Murray Streets, the Murray Road entrance, mm-hmm. on the right-hand side was the small post office at the corner of the building, which did not go into the interior of the building. But right in back of the post office then was the small area that was used for the Goodrich desk, because they had to have a place there for the Goodrich office. And off the Goodrich office was then the drugstore side. And of course, the drugstore was very adequately stocked. And of course, had a wonderful old ice cream fountain, soda fountain.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and lots of slot machines.
Was that run by Clarence?
Yeah, that would have been, yeah, that's right. And then off the back, then on the lake side, there was this screened-in porch on the Pitkin, on the drugstore side. There was always a hot game of hearts going on in that in that spot. Then on the other side of the building, on that tunnel, were the grocery store. And in the center of the building, there was a stairway which led upstairs. And upstairs, there were there were many rooms up there, so many people could live up there. In fact, my mother lived up there, and Leonard and I would stay down there over the weekend. There was excellent, excellent kitchen up there, nice rooms, and the room up in front, which overlooked the lake, that room was used by Hilder Homain, who later on became Hilder Dam. She was the beauty operator up there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Always a beauty parlor.
There was always a beauty parlor. And then that pretty much covered that building. But at the side was what originally had been the baggage building.
Wow.
And that with the baggage building for the Goodrich thing. And then Carmi Guerin took over that building and made a very attractive gift shop in there. Walhalla.
Walhalla. Huh?
Walhalla.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, yeah. Very, very attractive shop. And which, so here you were with a center spot on at a resort.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Had postal facilities, travel facility.
Hair boutique, everything.
Yeah, everything and anything you could ask for. Yeah.
I'll be darned.
Yeah. And of course, in those days, why there was the dock out in front where the boat came in, and the boat would come in over the weekend, and that was one of the things that Leonard was responsible for, was to get on there at the corner of the dock and direct the boat in on one of those foggy mornings. Huh. And the way he would direct them in was by hitting an old garbage can.
Just make enough noise?
Make enough noise to bring the boat in.
Oh,
sure.
Darn.
Yeah. So.
That is wild.
Yeah. Well, it really is. Leonard had a wonderful time there down there and made many friends, who were very important. But Mrs. Chittenden, Harriet's mother, invariably, if it was a cold morning, she'd bring coffee down to him so he'd keep warm. I can remember the morning she even brought a heavy sweater down because he hadn't brought a sweater down to the lake.
Well, that was certainly nice.
Yeah. So, yeah.
So Leonard he had somebody taking care of him somewhat.
He certainly did. He certainly did. So, and talking about the post office being in the original building, then later on, the building that was used as the storage building down there, and where Carmi had her gift shop, that was moved over across the road and became the post office. See, and then that's about the time that building, then the main building was torn down because it evidently had been there for a lot of years and it was too expensive to replace it.
Okay, so.
Yeah. So then the post office was moved across the road. And of course, that was the greatest place to have the post office, and I say that only personally, because there was the little porch at the side which overlooked the tennis courts, so when there wasn't much doing, I could watch all the tennis tournaments down there.
Well, that was nice. You had a little special sports spectacular going.
That's right.
Your spare time.
Yeah, so that's...
When the arcade was simply, you said it was just too expensive to replace it.
That I judge.
Who originally built it?
I have no idea. Wait a minute. Who? Somebody. All right. Jack Mason should have known that.
I don't know if I ask him.
Yeah.
I don't even remember that.
Mm-hmm.
I would be interested in whether Sylvan or some private entrepreneur.
Yeah, and I can't. I doubt that there's anything in that book, in our Sylvan Beach book, that tells who built that.
Well, think about that, and if you know of anybody to ask, or you can think about it. That'd be great, because, I don't know. Well, it sounds like a lot of folks don't know.
Well, no, that's right. This is what we're trying to find.
Find out, get all these things down.
True.
What were the names of the boats that came in and docked there? You mentioned the Carolina, didn't you?
The Carolina was the main one that came in with passengers.
Okay.
And of course, those people would come in on a Saturday morning and then leave again on Sunday night. Was one of the greatest methods of transportation. The boat.
Fantastic.
Yeah, or even our train transportation, which we've lost along the way.
Good point.
Yeah.
Good, very good point. Because that worked well, too.
Sure.
The Goodrich ship, then, the Carolina, would leave Chicago at what time? A Friday afternoon, 5?
Oh, no. Well, quite late in the afternoon.
Okay.
It would be after the men would, they would leave Chicago on Friday evening. So it would be mostly after men were through in their offices, and they'd head right for the boat dock. But you've got plenty of people, I'm sure, around who can answer that. Person I'm suggesting is Bill Hartz.
Bill Hartz, very good. And then Peggy Van, too.
Yeah.
The Bill Hartz had one.
Bill particularly, because Bill... I find Bill has a great recollection of many of these facts.
Wow, great.
And I only found that out just this last year when I was out for dinner with him. All of a sudden he's asking me, what did CC stand for? So then I'm having to say, you're talking about my father. And he said, yes. And I said, well, Charles Christian was his name. And he could remember my father. So this is why I feel that maybe Bill could remember. And the other person that can remember a lot about the arcade is Peggy Dilley.
I've called her. I want to get her to see what
listening. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, that's a good point, though, especially those two. And Bill Hartz, especially, I want to get. I never realized he was at Pearl Harbor. Pearl Harbor was attacked. I read it in an old Yacht Club news. He was right there.
Mm-hmm. But The fact that Bill was recalling some of these things that night we were at dinner was quite interesting to me.
Yeah, amazing. Yes.
Yeah. So, yeah.
What volume of business did you do there? Do you have any memory of the high points of the summer? Did you do $50 worth of business a day?
I have no idea. I really don't know, but evidently, after all, we were supplying a lot of people down there.
Right. Who had
of course, I'm talking about the days of the arcade, see. Mm-hmm. And I doubt that the volume was very big.
But the margin probably for profit was pretty
and
good.
So that's, of course, after all, just a limited amount of things handled on the grocery side. But of course, in those days too, wait a minute, you had an ice man who delivered. You've got a milk man who delivers. You would have a vegetable man. After all, Wheezy's would have been delivering vegetables by horse and wagon in those days.
So they would come out to
the
arcade?
That's right. Yeah, sure, they'd come right down there, you see. And after all, milkman was regular, was a regular delivery, possibly 3 days a week.
Yes.
So that took care of your milk, your cream, your butter, eggs. That's in that.
Okay.
So you see the.
And then the ice man would probably be also the one that had to cut the ice out of the lake in the wintertime.
Well, that's right. Of course, you had those. Yeah.
Yeah, they had the ice houses around at that time. Would do that. You mentioned in the 20s, we're in. Do you have any recollection? I suppose Hollywood's done this to us more than anything else. Although I've heard stories. You have any recollection of gangsters traveling through, or hoods, or shady characters?
There evidently were plenty of them. And of course, I mean, there. And I'm not going to repeat the story that I know, but I do know that we had somebody within the lake who was traveling out of here and picking up booze during the Prohibition days. And I'm sure you've heard that same story.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and strange to say, I was up at north on Scenic Drive. Just this would be west of Shelby the other night. And so I was saying, oh boy, this area is all so familiar to me. And so I'm saying, yes, you go right up over this hill, why, that's where we had all these gangsters up there, see? So they were not only spotted here, but they were also spotted north of us. And I know that after Leonard and I went into business, which would have been in 34, we had someone on the other side of the lake who were new people within the area that had a big boat. And I'll tell you, if you ever saw the gangsters, it was them. They used to come into the store and go into the big refrigerator and pick out the kind of meat they wanted.
Oh, they just kind of sauntered on in.
They would mark what they wanted, you know.
I'll be darned.
Yeah, and they didn't want anything but the fillets of beef and prime rib.
Yeah, the best.
Nothing but the best.
They were on a boat.
They were on a boat over here.
Do you remember the name of the boat?
Yeah, it was Dunham's.
Dunham's?
Yeah, Dunham, and that's... That would be down just beyond Pax in that area.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, see, Pack and Dunham both had the big boats.
Okay. Now, Al Pack wasn't any gangster, and he was just a businessman.
Oh, but he was mixed up with the liquor thing.
Yeah, he was.
And, of course, I think it's always worthwhile to remember about Pack's boat. that when Pax, you knew when Pax's boat was coming into the lake, because he had a calliope on that boat.
I'll be darned.
And as he would come through the channel, they would play who?
Oh, they'd play the whole, I'll be darned.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That was beautiful. That was beautiful.
Oh, I mentioned it once.
And hearing that come up the lake, you say, it's because after all, it came up the lake all the way to right across,
and
right across here. Sure, sure. Time. Yeah. Oh.
That is one.
Yeah.
So those were generally your just general impressions and memories of the gangsters. You hit on something.
Because we
probably didn't ask questions, you know.
No. You just saw them around in their long black coats and their big black cigars. And they were typical. They were typical of what you knew about the Chicago gangster. And after all, they were close enough. When you think about it.
Yeah. Perfect place to come and hide.
That's right. That's right.
Sure, nice place to be.
But I know the other day when I said something about this thing right outside of Stony Lake, and I'm saying this, my friend Maxine says, oh, you've heard about that too. And I said, oh, sure. And that's been, yeah. Yeah. So.
I've heard stories myself that Clarence, told my dad, and they were around here somewhat.
Well, that's right, of course.
You know, as you said, handy place to be. We're dealing now in the 20s with Prohibition, and do you have memories of people here in town making wine or beer?
Oh, no question about that, because we used to have the malt mixture that was needed for making the beer.
Oh, from the store, yeah.
Oh, sure. And there was always bootleg stuff available. I don't think anyone that had a car with a trunk in it didn't have some bootleg in their car. Yeah.
Yeah.
A particular in the, all right, okay, that puts me back into when I was in the early 20s.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. It was nothing to...
And everybody just kind of blinked about it.
No, everybody blinked, and maybe you just took a couple swallows to look smart, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're cool, or something.
No, you're real. Yes, you'd have been cool in those days. You're right.
outside of
the few characters that we had in town, I don't think you ever really saw anyone really inebriated.
Flagrantly.
That's right. I do remember that our one police officer, you notice I say one.
Raleigh Merrick.
We found Raleigh Merrick on our front porch out here one morning. He'd evidently had a little bit too much. But there were these other people who, Squeaky Johnson, for instance, a few of these marvelous characters that there
were. Can you tell us some more about these characters?
Oh, God.
Squeaky Johnson?
It's funny, I could remember Squeaky. Well, wait a minute. One by the name of But there were three or four characters we had in town. Oh, one of them being Tom Havlick. One was Squeaky Johnson. I want to say Quesnut. I think I'm right about that, but I can't remember his first name. He was the guy who always came into the store and bought vanilla because of the alcohol content in a bottle of vanilla.
Yes, yes.
See, because they couldn't get the liquor they wanted, so that's what they drank, the vanilla.
So it was a pretty flagrantly violated law.
That's right.
I guess it's...
And of course, after all, with our place to shut them up in that one little quarter over in the old fire building.
Now that's in back of the bank, the old bank?
Not in back of the bank. It'd be in back of Kleinfelder's. Okay. You see, all right, there was Kleinfelder's store, and then there was that funeral home, G's funeral home.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And then the next building was this real old building in there that was the was the old fire barn, and that's where the fire department was there, and the small jail, and upstairs was the library.
Okay.
Yeah. So then there was another building beyond that, which would have been put it about where Marantz is now, or very close to that section there.
Okay.
That was a a dust layer place. And very few people even know what I'm talking about when I'm talking about that. But strange to say, when my father first got here, he got mixed up with this man who was making dust layer. And what they were using the sawdust from the mills plus sand plus oil. Now, whether this was oil from the cars or what, that's all mixed together, and then that was thrown on the floors when you swept the floors. And you see most of those old buildings, when you think about it, when you get back to the old building, which would have been in the area just beyond where the Masonic Temple is now, where Colby Place, all right.
Yeah, okay.
You know, there were three small buildings and they're almost identical.
Okay.
And one was a tailor's shop, another was a tobacconist shop, and the third one was a justice a judge's, Judge Dodge's was
Judge
in there.
Dodge,
yeah.
Okay.
Someplace amongst, if we need to review some stuff, I've got some stuff written up about those places somewhere or another. But that was, so that.
Yeah, if you could look those up sometime,
yeah,
if you come back.
Yeah. Because, of course, you see, that was before the professional building was put in there. That professional building wasn't put in there until the late 40s, someplace. So those places were in there, plus the old M11 garage down there.
I'll be darned.
Yeah. Of course, we've gotten a long ways away from the beach at this point, but then. We decided we'd talk about the town anyway, so.
Yeah, that's right. I want to get all about the town that I could get also. We were talking again. We were into Prohibition and that. It seems to be, as you said, flagrantly violated by everybody, the federal.
Oh, yeah, everybody. I don't know anybody that didn't have bootleg.
The
yeah, I mean, and you had them in these strange bottles.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And people were going to jail and even capital punishment for making it and selling it. And
that's right.
So much.
And there was always beer being made in the basement. And I know this because my father made beer all the time.
Yeah, I know my grandfather made wine.
Well, sure.
Well, I guess. So much for drug laws, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, so much for people obeying the law.
Yeah, I guess things never change, you know?
That's right. Just
the problem is we seem to forget.
Well, this is what I say. We can hope for the best, and that's all we can do. But really, times haven't changed that much.
No, I agree with you.
Mm-mm.
The farms change, but the people don't. Yeah. I mean, what they do. On Sylvan Beach, do you remember any rum running down there? Was there anybody selling to people on Sylvan Beach?
I don't remember that.
Okay, of course, right along in this period, I guess at Sylvan Beach, things were very nice and that. Do you remember the onset of the Great Depression and what changes that brought about for Whitehall, Sylvan Beach, or whatever you can remember, 1929, the end of the 30s? Was it Just tell me your memories of the Depression.
Oh, what? All right. This, of course, is before we went in for Leonard and I. Leonard and I bought our business, bought the building downtown, right during the middle of the Depression. Okay. Right in the middle of the Depression. But before that, Leonard had worked in Muskegon at the Continental and then was laid off. Then he went to work at the tannery. And when things really got bad, anyone who had a job at the tannery was asked to divide their time with someone else so that everybody could get a little bit of their spoon into the pot, so to speak. So I know that for 2 weeks' work, Leonard would bring home $15. And by the time I got my shopping done and knew that I had enough food and we were able to pay what little bills we had to pay, because after all, everybody cut their own wood. We use wood stoves, wood furnaces. Mm-hmm. You could even have used oil lamps.
Would that have been whale oil or just fuel oil?
Fuel oil. Well, there was a special kind of oil we used to buy for the lamps. Well, after all, if we had kerosene lamps, you see.
Okay, yeah, your kerosene.
Yeah, that's right. But I always said that by the time that I managed to do with my $15 for those 2 weeks, I was lucky if I had a nickel left over for a for a candy bar.
Oh yeah.
But what we did, if you had anyone in for the evening, you just had a big bowl of popcorn.
I'll be darned.
Yeah.
Cheap entertainment.
And those were the days of when people really got into their home and gathered.
And entertain themselves.
That's right, entertained. Yeah. That's
something
right.
We've forgotten how to do.
That's right. We've lost so much of these natural things, Zero.
Do you ever feel that you were very lucky to be raised during the period of history you were in this country?
I feel that I have lived here in the best times that could have been.
I think if I had to, I've often thought of this, I would have gone back to the similar
time. Because we are missing too many close friendships these days.
Yeah. Too fast.
Everybody is doing something else rather than really getting to know one another.
That's right.
Yeah. And of course, this was the marvelous thing about being in business in a smaller store in a small town, that we were able to make so many good friends.
Yeah, that's true, because people come in, you would talk, just, you know.
And the good friends who have meant so much through my lifetime now, because being in my nifty 90s, you know, why, you've lived a long time.
Now, just for the record now, how old are you?
Yeah, I'm 90.
90, I'll be done.
Yeah.
You don't look a day over 60. Yeah, you really don't. That's great.
Thank you.
I guess it was all that chopping, all that wood, and eating that popcorn.
Something must have done. No.
That's exciting. And I guess nowadays you're right with TV. People, even when they do get together, they're watching something and they don't entertain themselves.
No.
They don't even know how to tell stories anymore. And I just remember.
It's a different lifestyle,
yeah.
And that's all you can. Can say things have come too fast, too furiously. Our young people are not being allowed to grow up.
Yeah. Yeah.
Little kids haven't got time to play anymore.
Exactly. Allow them their childhood.
Yeah.
You know, they're all in a rush to get ahead, make money or whatever it is, and it's a shame.
Yeah.
It's a shame. Do you have any memories of Prohibition, anything that happened? Anybody ever get caught here? Was there ever anybody, for instance, I've heard a story that my grandfather had the superintendent of Whitehall Schools over for a drink one time, and the man lost his job because he had been drinking. You know, he was in charge of the schools. You don't remember anything?
Well, that possibly would have been typical of that period. And this is something I thought about the other day as I was looking through the news from our local school and realizing how few of these teachers I have not had the opportunity of talking to.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because our school system has become so big since it's consolidated.
Yeah.
There has not been the chance of becoming acquainted. And of course, years ago, talking about the school teachers, that's something else. Years ago, many of those school teachers used to room within a household.
I'll be darned.
Oh, sure.
So they were more of a visible, integral
part. That's right. So they were really part of the community. So hence, all right, even Leonard and I had two of them who lived at our house. Okay. You took them in at a very minimal rate. They had a bed. They had good food.
Mm-hmm.
And many of the school teachers, just exactly as they used to out in the country, lived in the homes.
Mm-hmm. So it was, they were very much part of the families around town that they taught. So there probably wasn't a lot secret then either.
No. Well, all right. And then later on, all of a sudden, we had the old Mears Hotel downtown.
The old Mears Hotel?
Mears. Mears, after Charlie Mears, which would have been where Joe Jeff's is now.
Okay.
And then later on, that became the Colonial Inn.
Hmm.
And a number of the teachers at school lived at the Colonial Inn.
Oh,
yeah.
They just rented rooms there?
They just rented a room, and of course, yeah. And of course, I have a feeling that maybe some of them even helped wait table.
Maybe just, yeah.
To get a little extra money. There's no question about that. Okay, Marge and Everett G. were married in that old Colonial Inn, by the way.
Okay.
Which later on burned down. That has to be in about 37 or 38. The Colonial Inn, for some reason or another, caught fire and burned down. So after all, there were all the firemen out there, and we were pulling everything out of our... See, we were right across the street, Leonard and Edna's food shop. We're quite across the street, so we figured those walls are going to come, and they're going to come right through our big windows. So we're emptying everything we can out of the windows, but getting rid of all the important papers in there.
Yeah.
Then we're getting the truck out, the old panel truck, which we had, and going over and picking up all the liquor.
Oh, good Lord.
Out of the bar.
Gotta save that.
Yeah, got taking it out of the bar. So our truck is filled with liquor for a couple days so we could find a place to store it. We had all the liquor from the bar. Well, and also what happened after all? This all involved the old mortuary, which is where I told you that was in bed. Yeah, all right. They had to move the hearse out of there to get the hearse someplace else so it wouldn't be caught in that fire.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Sure. So there were a few exciting things happening.
Once in a while. Woke up. Did you have a fire bell in town, a big bell you rang?
Oh, sure. Oh, sure. And then,
now,
of course, you see. And also the whistle, you see.
Oh,
you see, well, wait a minute. That fire bell, one of them is up there in Slocum Park now.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah.
Up in Slocum Park, where one of the
fire... By the City Hall.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was one of the fire bells.
Yes, yeah, it was one of the...
Was the whistle at the tannery?
Oh, yeah. Whistle was at the tannery. Okay. The whistle was at the tannery.
Did you have different amounts of blast to signal
Depending on what part of town. I think it was one for downtown, two for the, and three for Swedentown.
Okay.
Two for Bunker Hill, I should say. And of course, after all, we had Tilly Gustavus, who was the telephone operator, and the telephone building being right down here. You know where the old telephone building.
Same place.
Same place, that same building right now. After all, she slept down there. So when the alarm came in, everybody went to their phone to find out where the fire was. So everybody'd, yeah.
I'll be darned.
Yeah, and of course everybody headed for the fires. Everybody, because I can remember the number of nights that I got up out of bed, put on something warm, and go along with Leonard because he was on the fire department.
Wow. At this time in the 20s, were there still, what was the percentage of horses to cars, or were there horses left in Whitehall at that time? Did people still have carriages and wagons that were horse-drawn?
Not too many.
So progress, or whatever you want to call it, a lot of cars.
Yeah, well, of course, but there were lots of, after all, you had those two garages downtown. Wait a minute, which would have been the old M11, and the other one was where Bell's Furniture is right now.
Okay.
There was a garage there. And listen, I can if you're interested in knowing about that place, Bud Stoy, because after all, he and his brother were in the trucking business.
Okay.
Yeah, and they did all. You see that everything was brought in. Most everything was brought in by truck.
Okay.
In the period I'm talking about right now, in the 30s.
Right.
Because after all, anything that we purchased wholesale was brought in by Wolverine Truck, which takes me back to somebody else.
Mr. Diamond?
Ina Diamond.
Ina Diamond, yeah. Good point. I have to get Ina.
Yeah, listen, and get Ina now.
Be quick. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Down on Sylvan Beach, what memories do you have of being down there? Memories of a daily existence, the memories of people. Can you give us a few names of the people that you would do business with down there?
Well, so many. It's about the same parts of the family that are down there now. But one of the nice things down there was the fact that the post office was the gathering point.
Okay. That
and if you felt you were going to extend any invitations, you went to the post office about a certain time, because you know that the mail is going to be sorted by a certain time. By the way, Sandra Kelly was the one who brought in the mail, and Sandra was part of the Brightwell family.
Okay.
Oh. So she was the one who was responsible for seeing that the mail was there. And believe me, Sandra, she was very, very prompt. Usually the mail was in at the post office by 9:30 in the morning.
And it was in the slots and everything?
No, what the mail was delivered in, okay. With the big sack and so forth.
Did the sack come by boat or did it come?
No, that she brought that down by car.
Okay.
She brought that down by car.
Okay.
And at one time, originally, there were two sacks brought in. One sack was brought in from Michelinda Beach Lodge, and another, Michelinda Beach Lodge. And the other sack was brought in for Wabanango. The Wabanango sack was opened immediately, and that was sorted. And usually within 20 minutes or so, all the mail would be ready to be taken out of the out of those lock boxes. So there were always certain people who came every morning about a certain time.
Yeah.
We always had one person, and I'm not naming anybody, but we had one person who always picked up her mail who was always drinking a bottle of beer.
I'll be darned, in the morning they'd come down and she'd have a bottle of beer. And this is during Prohibition, too.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
A prominent family, too, I would imagine.
Yeah, that's right. But as a whole, those were the mornings that you would always, somebody would meet one another and they'd say, well, how about coming up and have a drink with me at 4:30 this afternoon? I think all the cocktail parties were all planned
in the post office. Probably even started there,
It always seemed that way anyway, you know. So that's it.
Well, that brings me to an interesting question. Do you feel nowadays, you know, it seems like there's a cocktail party every 20 minutes, every weekend day, every day of the summer and that. Back then, in the 20s and 30s, in your memory of Sylvan Beach, was it as hard-driving social as it is now? Cocktail parties always going on, or was it...
No. It was not like that at all, because I think what was happening was just a one-on-one type of thing.
People just came here to relax.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. See, all of a sudden, it got out of hand.
Yes, I agree. I feel that way.
Yeah. Well, listen, there are many people down there feel the same way. Because they feel that they never... Because actually, they have these cocktail parties, and who has a chance to really talk to one another?
That's right. And what are you talking about?
Yeah, see, this has been a nice day, you know. Yeah.
I have 3 years ago myself, somebody, because I like to spend time alone reading and doing things, mm-hmm. and I had somebody actually threaten me that I'd start better going to the parties, you mm-hmm. know, like it was a fraternity or something, and I just went, you know, I'm not going to live my life the way your definition is. I didn't join a fraternity in college, I'm not going to join one now. I love Sylvan Beach, and I love the people, mm-hmm. but I'm not going to go out and party every night. That's not why I came to Sylvan Beach.
No, that's right.
You know, I love the magic, the smell in the woods, the reading at night.
Yeah.
You know, not that I have anything against parties. You know me, I partied a lot when I was young, but hey, whoa, you know, that's, calm down.
Oh, somewhere along the line, you certainly have to have somebody told you about the young man who blew the trumpet and serenaded
him. I have that question written right down here. Would you go in and explain it? Who that was? Reitz?
Reitz.
Now he would get up and...
Go out in his boat at night.
At dusk?
And there, of course, you know, there's nothing lovelier than the sound across the lake.
Yes.
And he would play all these lovely tunes, wooing his girlfriend down there.
Well, really, that's what was the motive, huh?
Yeah, oh, sure.
Because my father's told me how pretty it was.
Oh,
what a
yeah.
beautiful thing it yeah. was. And how many years did that go on? He'd just go out in a canoe or a rowboat? And
yeah.
Just how long would he play the trumpet for?
Well, you know, maybe half an hour or something that like is. That. Because I think everybody sort of listened for that, waited for that, because it was so beautiful. And he was an excellent musician, so that all helped. He wasn't playing a lot of sour notes. So.
Yes, you know, it's funny, my father even saw him several years ago down in Florida, 10 years ago, something like, and he plays a trumpet in a fancy club.
Oh, mm-hmm.
About 12, 15 years ago, I believe, something like that.
All right, you know... Wait a minute, Judy Reitz. Yeah, Judy Reitz lives in South Whitehall now.
Yeah, Ed stayed in my cottage, my parents' cottage,
mm-hmm.
when he was a kid.
Mm.
And as it turns out, that Reitz family was the guy, he just died, he did the TV show mm-hmm. Eight Is Enough, Robert Reed.
Mm, yeah.
He changed his name from Reitz to Reed. He stayed in our cottage mm-hmm. this summer, so he had no one bad either. On the
I'm
social
getting into
aspect,
the full sun here.
Pardon?
I'm getting into full sun. You think we want to pull that drape a little bit, or is it going to cut?
Is it bothering you?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, then we'll put it on pause, right? This is the meat of history.
Well, you see, you don't give a chance to sit down and talk these things.
Yeah,
so.
I, you know, the facts, and I mean, the dates and all the other stuff in history are meaningless to me. It's what the people did every day of their lives that's of interest. That I think is important to remember.
Of course, I think one of the great things about the beach is something that's been missing is the beach for the children. Even though it's still there, it is not used in the same way as it used to.
That's a very good point.
Yeah, because when, and I wonder if this has something to do with the fact that the post office is not where it used to be.
Could be.
But see, the post office was right across the, and so people naturally came down with their children.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're right.
And took them over to the beach.
Sure.
The beach. The beach is not. At least this is what I hear.
Well, it's not. It's not. You're right. It's no more near what I when I was a child. You know, it was certainly always crowded and jammed, and they even used to have to hire a lifeguard.
Mm-hmm.
You know. Yeah. That's a very good point.
Yeah.
Very good point. Perhaps this has to do with more of the social change, too.
That could be.
I know talking to Barb Wagner and to some other people, I sense a great deal of magic of being at Sylvan Beach. The smells in the woods, the swims at night, just the magic of the Indian trails that may have been there. And now, as we had mentioned, we certainly have turned into more of a social cocktail.
Yeah, that's right.
And we've lost, I think, perhaps a great deal of the essence of Sylvan Beach. Not that it's bad.
No. It's that life change which is coming with everything.
Everything. And
everything.
Life changes all the time.
So. No matter what.
Yeah.
Because we have more commuters, more computers, not commuters, more computers, more computers. And I see the electric company is complaining because of the use of electricity.
I'll be darned.
Yeah, because of all the gadgets that are being used now.
Well, that's true too. The amount of electricity being used.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. Everything we.
That's right.
And now they're finding out problems that it may affect our brain, the electric force fields. So,
yeah, that's right.
You
that's
know,
right.
You know,
we better be glad we've been here when we've been here.
I think you're right. I think you're exactly right. And I'm glad that I will probably go out of this world before I hope it changes too drastically. You know, I don't want to get used to anything new as I get older. You know. Can you tell me, I guess you can't hit on White Lake without a discussion of the Sedonies, in your experience with the Sedonies. Do you have any stories? Did Mr. Sedoni come and shop in your store?
You know, I think the Sedoni family is very difficult to talk about because he was such a very unusual man, a very helpful man with many people, always very friendly. And Lily Sedoni was the same way, very attractive woman, extremely so.
Mm-hmm.
Too many things once in a while because of the fact of what Joe Sr. did.
Mm-hmm.
As being, and because he was a mental giant, no question about that. He had a way with words that a lot of us did not understand what he was talking about. And I say that in a kind way, because I liked Joe Sedoni very much. But so often then you get a lot of rumors which are not good.
No, gossip.
And particularly in a small community, anybody who is that different from the average really must have a very difficult time in the beginning. I'm sure that Joe and Art were two people who realized that as young people.
Yes.
Well.
Yeah, you're right. I haven't thought about a small community and the stories.
Well, it's that same thing that you, after all, going back to different people within the community. After all, here we are in Whitehall, for years having been the only community that has had a black family in it.
Right.
That black family are held in the highest regard.
As they should be, yes.
But had they been maybe, shall we say, in Muskegon or any place else, they'd have had a very difficult time.
Very hard time.
Particularly the way things are right now.
You're right.
I think the Sedonis, Joe, after all, evidently was very fortunate that somebody found that spot over there in Valley of the Pines, which was so perfect.
Mm-hmm.
He could get out of the average run of people and have his life to himself. Very interesting. It's a very interesting family, and I have such a high regard for the whole family.
Everybody I've talked to feels the same way.
Yeah.
Certainly a unique part of our history.
Now, by the way, have you talked to young Foster by any chance?
No. Foster?
Now, this would be the minister's son that lives down in South Whitehall. I can't remember what his first name is.
Minister Foster.
Yeah, the minister's son. He did a lot of research on Sedoni.
Okay.
Because I know he was down and talked to Peg Van. He talked to somebody else down at the lake also. Because he had a recorder very similar to what you're using here right now.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll try to research.
Yes, yeah, so you might be able to...
Yeah, put it together. That's what I wanted to do.
Put something together.
You got to follow every lead.
Yeah, that's right. But this will keep you busy for a while.
Well, yeah, I'll tell you, the chronic fatigue does it enough. This is a love. This is more of a love. History was my love in life, and White Lake's my love in life.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
It's okay. So, another question. Can you think of you? Very famous family, running the store at the arcade, running the store downtown. You knew everybody, anybody.
Yeah.
They'd have to come to you to get food many times. Can you tell us the most famous person that you've met that came to White Lake? Or plural of that.
The only person I'm thinking of, if you're saying this, is not because they were famous, but they were so very noticeable. And that was Edith Sturtevant.
Why is that?
She'd evidently been a chorus girl. Not only very good looking, but also the Sturtevants had lots of money. See, they lived on the Montague side,
okay,
over beyond PAX. Wait a minute, your mother would have known Edith Sturtevant.
Okay.
Not your mother, your grandmother.
Edith
would have known. So
she was quite a character.
She
right?
was quite a character. She was always surrounded by three or four good looking men, all much younger than her own husband. It's funny, I don't know why you thought about her, but only because of that, you know.
I'll be darned.
Yeah, no.
You don't remember, you no recollections of, I've heard Amos and Andy came in here before.
Well, of course, you see, those people came in because of Sedoni.
Yes.
Because his laboratory over there was filled with pictures of all. See, there were many Hollywood people. Many Hollywood people.
Could you name some offhand?
Well, I don't remember them now.
But I have heard that myself, man, like Joan Crawford, Sophie Tucker, different names like that.
Yeah, that's right.
That did come to him. When the Great Depression hit in Whitehall, did you notice very much happening in Whitehall at that time? did the tourist business drop off after 1920?
No, tourist business did not drop off.
Okay.
No, tourist business stayed pretty much the same. There might have been a little change in the way people were able to pay their bills.
As you said.
Of course, those are the days of charge accounts.
Those are the days
of charge accounts and also of delivery service. So you might wait until the next spring to get your check for last summer's groceries.
I see.
But you always knew you were going to get it.
Yes.
So people were coming up here because the summer was so important for them to get away from what was happening. As far as, there were never too many shortages, actually, only because of the fact that, now I'm into the years of when Leonard and I were in business.
Great.
I went into Chicago one day a month. What I would do, I would fly into Chicago on a Sunday night, stay at the hotel, and in the morning I would head for the wholesale houses. Because I had found that there were shortages which were available if I would go into the city.
Okay.
So hence, our store never really suffered from having shortages.
But,
and Leonard and I had made it we had gone into Chicago several times into Armour and Company, Swift and Company, and also we had good friends at Plankington in Milwaukee. So we never really knew what it was to have shortages.
Ruth Guggen, Edson's, owned the Armour Meatpacking Company. Did you see her when you were in Chicago?
Well, wait a minute. She was from farther. She was out of Kansas City, wasn't she?
She might have been.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Yeah, I think in fact we dealt with that company too. But we'd gotten so we were acquainted with some of these people so that they knew us.
Mm-hmm.
And if there was the quality type of thing we wanted, we got it.
Yeah.
And you see, going into Chicago.
Yeah, you going in with the way you did.
I would spend from one wholesale, three different big wholesale houses. And of course, that stuff was then all shipped into Whitehall by Wolverine Express. That's the way, and then of course, what happened in the shortages. And I found this out just recently by reading something or another that I have in my possession. That we went through a period of where we were limiting one chicken per week. And I had not remembered that at any time. But I do know this, that when the meat would come in the back door, immediately we had a big curtain which we pushed across the front of the meat counter. And then the meat would be brought in and handled the way it should be. And if there was a package of bacon that come in, we would take a package of bacon, a pound package, and break it down in two. See? Mm-hmm. So we're taking care of two people instead of one person.
Right.
The cigarettes were hidden under the counter, and boy, you had to have a priority list to get a package of cigarettes. That's right. But of course, you see, that's easy to do when you have a few customers and these people you know who are regulars. You haven't the guy coming in that's bleeding you for everything. In those days, after all the fat was saved, all these things during those war years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the aluminum foil.
There was a big change here during the war years, once the Depression and then the war years.
Yeah, you see one right on top of the other, the whole thing.
Yes.
And of course, when during the, of course, then, and of course, we always had plenty of fresh fish around here, too.
That's true, the boats operated.
Yes, you see, with Grovers and Fishers down here.
Okay, now the Grovers and...
And the Fishers were the... Where the people on the Montague side
died on those channels.
That's right.
I remember Roger Gunderson, I believe, worked for them for years.
Yeah.
I worked with him at the tannery. Yeah, so you had the fishermen down there that were bringing in fresh fish every
day. That's right. That's right. Where you see what you don't have anymore.
Yeah.
That's another lost cause.
Yeah, you're right.
And after all, even they aren't getting them even on White Lake, from what I hear.
They might even be poisoned once we get them, so you don't even know.
No. That's right. That's
so you really have quite a, with your going into Chicago and then with fresh fish. I mean, I've always heard when I was growing up from my grandparents and my father that the Bloomdahl name is comparable to the Smithsonian almost. I mean, it was the place to get the food. The people from Sylvan Beach and everywhere went and got the best food.
And we tried to do a good job. And I'd still say, I'm bragging at this moment, that many of the things that we did kept many people coming back.
I think you probably.
Well, every Christmas there was always, we always used a small desk card, and that was sent to every one of our customers as a Christmas greeting. Those were the things. And in the spring, when we knew it was just about time that people were beginning to think about their cottage, I would have lists made out, which were, and all they had to do was fill in, well, they needed 5 pounds of flour and needed that.
Good for you, yeah.
Sure. And then delivery date, are you going to need ice? Are you going to need this? Are you going to need that? See, and those are all the things that have been lost along the way. But Leonard and I did a fabulous job of it.
Oh, I gather that you two did. You filled every need.
And yeah, that's right.
Would Leonard drive the car and drop off the food?
Later on. Then we always had a delivery boy. In fact, Ned O'Connell, if you'd see Ned O'Connell, she'd tell you, well, after all, she was always looking for Tony to come by in the truck because she was heading down to the beach to babysit.
She'd be checking to see if
I think our truck carried more babysitters
than anybody else. That's great. Than anything else. Yeah. And diapers and everything.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
that's funny.
No, it's been a great life.
Certainly has been. Do you have any other memories of the war years, how they affected Sylvan Beach or Whitehall? Rationing, was it strictly enforced?
Rationing was very strictly enforced. And gas rationing was very strictly enforced. And because of the fact that we not only delivered, but also it was necessary for us to go out into the country to pick up perishables and so forth. So when last week when I was on that with my friends, I'm saying, oh yeah, we did all these roads because we would go up in there to pick up any produce out of their garden that was possible, you know, all these things. All our lamb was picked up out there. Chickens were picked up. These things are all done after hours, you know?
Yeah, after regular hours.
That's right.
So it sounds like you put in a lot of 18, 19-hour days.
That's right. I used to figure that I used to put in between 75 and 80 hours a week.
Wow.
Of course, after all, we did, you know, in those days we did all our own slaughtering of the chickens and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
And Leonard, with his big hands, he could clean 50 chickens an hour.
God, you're kidding me.
Of course, he had these marvelous hands that were so great and could do anything. A man could stand and do all this fancy spider web caning and everything. You know what kind of hands he had. So.
God, he must have feathers flying around him like a
room. That's right. Yeah, and
ball of snow going down.
Every once in a while, somebody will tell about this. You know, they get to thinking about this, particularly one of those great people that worked for us. And that's something else. We had so many fine people who worked for us. They had to work in those days. They had to work.
Yeah, they didn't have any.
But there was much more for them to do around than there is now. It's a different type of thing. So.
It's a very good point. You needed somebody to pluck the chickens. You needed somebody to...
Boy, I'll tell you, I pin-feathered more chickens.
Oh, that's great. Now, how long, year-wise, date-wise, you operated in the arcade from what year to what year?
Well, now, let's see. Wait a minute. I'm going to have to talk in terms of my father.
No problem.
So my father would have been, he would have been in the arcade from 1924, wait just a minute, about 1939. Because eventually he took over the grocery, okay. or the drug side. Okay. So he had the whole thing eventually. And also had the post office.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Of course, in that period in between, we had a little problem in the family, so that's neither here nor there at this point. So, yeah. And I went down to the post office, I don't know, 80, I was in the post office for 12 years. So it would have been about in 58 that Lila Spickelmeyer, something happened. Lila got sick and she needed a helper. By that time, we were just out of business downtown. And I went down and took over the post office. And the next year, she thought, well, gee, I was familiar. Why didn't I take it over? And that's how. So I was in there for 12 years.
For 12 years.
Yeah, yeah. And the post office was a wonderful gathering spot for the younger kids. A wonderful place.
Sure, they could have yeah, to figure out
what to do there. Well, they'd come in and there'd be any magazines around, they'd sit there and read, you know. So I just hope the other post office is used in the same way.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
How long did you have your store uptown? What year, from what year to what year?
Let's see, from 35
to 58. 35 to 58. Now, Leonard died when?
3 years ago. Oh. He died in 89.
I didn't realize it was that time.
Yeah, 3 years.
So then you sold the store, or you just closed it down?
What happened? We leased the store to A&P.
Okay.
And then A&P, Dell came in and took it over from A&P.
Okay, now, where was Nelson's department store?
Right, well, where Dell's would have been, wait a minute. You see, oh, wait a minute, why do I have to do that differently? Dancers now have that whole building.
Okay.
All right, the part which is the concrete block building, the newer part of that building, is the building that we put up. See, we put up a new building. We tore down the old building.
Okay.
We tore down the old building in 51.
Okay.
In 51. No, we closed up like about, just about at Christmas time, and we were back in business by the end of March.
Okay.
That's how fast that thing went. So we knew we had to do it.
That
the old building was in such terrible shape, really decrepit. It was ready to fall to pieces. So, and we had bought what was originally Jacobson's store, and then we bought the property right next. The property where that building on is now is actually where there were two buildings at one time.
Okay.
But we left part of that. That's why there is that parking space there beside Dancers.
Okay.
Because there was not a parking lot in back.
Okay, that's...
We tried to protect ourselves, and had the parking lot been back there, that building would have been larger.
Yeah.
It was the only way we could do it. So then Nelson's would have been right next door to us.
Yes.
See, it would have been a matter of Charlie Reed's old antique shop, and then what would have been Jacobson's store, and then Nelson's right next to it.
Okay.
And then after Dell was at there, in there, then we sold the building to Dick Fiat.
Dick Fiat?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, when we put up that building, that was to be our future, see? And well, it's the way it worked out, too.
Thank God, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we got a nice sum at the time.
Well, that's right. And I mean, we could invest it, which was important.
Yeah.
So it all worked out very well.
Do you have any other memories of Sylvan Beach that you'd like to share with us? Any thoughts, insights, memories, cares, concerns?
You know, Sylvan Beach Inn, Sylvan Beach Hotel.
Yes.
The great part of that... of that place. And I'm thinking about Mae Murray, who was, I'm saying the wrong word, I know, Mae Myers. Mae Myers, when she ran the Sylvan Beach Hotel. And that had such an excellent reputation.
It did.
Yeah, it really, really did. Well, and Murray's Inn, years ago.
Oh,
Murray's Inn, oh yes.
But the Sylvan Beach Hotel was really kind of the...
That's right in the middle of that
place. Yeah. And you were impressed by the...
Yeah, always. Always.
The good clientele and good health.
And we have several other places, too, if you're getting in, and I'm getting away from the beach only because I'm thinking about White Lake Villa.
Mm-hmm. You know, I can't remember the Rochdale Inn, too.
Well, Rochdale Inn, all right, and Idlewild.
Idlewild, yeah.
And, wait a minute, you've got Smith's down below, but we've had so many, many fine resorts around our lake.
You're right.
But there are still two, there are still several excellent ones left, being Michelinda Beach Lodge and... also, Lakeside Inn. But otherwise than that, there was all these other small hotels, which was... That's what brought a lot of these people in. White Lake Villa would have brought in lots of people.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of people. But even though they were staying at the hotels, they were still spending money.
Yes.
Within the area.
Yes. And they did bring in a lot of people. And
that's right.
They wanted to bring in a lot of people in the area, I'm sure, needed the...
Yeah.
I remember Clarence, My father told me that Clarence used to go out and get in his powerboat, and every boat that came in that channel, he would personally go out and greet. And
that's right.
The White Lake.
I don't think people realized how much Clarence did. I really don't.
Because
he never let it known, what he did with the White Lake Yacht Club, what that did for the area, and what and being sure that those little booklets were put out every so often, which were so great, everybody looked forward to that.
Forward to it, yes.
That's right.
The news. And I guess he founded the Western Michigan Yachting Association.
Yeah.
And he founded the Western Michigan Tourist Association.
Right, yeah. Right.
Yeah. From what I gather, it was always probably the most involved of all the people, the men that would go out and try to get...
Yeah, no question, no. He was a man who was a natural pusher. He was a natural developer.
Self-starter.
But for the, and not a developer for his benefit, but for the benefit of the community.
For the common good. Yeah.
There's that difference.
Oh, there's a big difference.
You bet.
We don't have men like that left hardly.
No. Mm-mm.
It's all me generation. And Edith, I guess, was she complimentary to Clarence? I mean, Edith seemed, from what I gather, to do all the book work and stuff.
Yes, she was a great helper. No question about that. You were never too aware of her, but she always looked very nice.
Just kind of
always well groomed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What are some of the other names around the G's? Do you have any memories of Evergee or Funnels or any interesting?
Well, after all, Lynn G, for instance, who was the funeral director at one time, very influential with as far as the Masonic Lodge was concerned. That sort
he
of thing.
He was instrumental then.
That's right. Okay. That's exactly right.
Okay, and the Funnels, I remember the name Funnels from the barbershop.
After all, Ray and Faye Funnel in the barbershop, and then...
I even had the honor when I was a child to get my hair cut in there.
Oh, sure.
The center where people always seen.
And of course, Anger, who had the little old meat market downtown.
I'll be done.
But you see, and that's something else that is... After all, now here we are with Plums, and then Plums moving out. So all these little stores that we used to have downtown are gone.
And the tax base.
After all, there was Angers over on Kleinfelder's side, and then up about a block was Lyons' little store. And then on coming across the street where we were, there was Leonard and Edna's, and there was Carlson's, and there was Connell's, Ken Connell's place there. And then you got down into the next block where there was White Lake Grocery. Then you go out this way, and you've got Marshall's. And Cap Peterson's. There's one more in there someplace. One more just in that same area, right across from the Lutheran Church. There was a grocery store in there. All those little stores seem to have survived in some way or another.
Another, yeah.
Oh, wait, I haven't mentioned one. Where the little shop is... Got such a funny name, I can't think of the name, but it's where originally, wait a minute, how, where Panzels were. Panzels, and later on, Stauffer's were in there, and then, Morris's. You see all these changes along the way.
Right, yeah.
But we had all these small stores. So no one, you see, had to walk very far to get their groceries when you think about it.
No, they were. Yeah,
yeah, and most of these people with only just regular ice boxes, they couldn't keep food very long anyway. So it was a matter of doing your shopping daily.
Certainly.
You see, you forget all that.
Very good point and very good insight.
Yeah.
That's the meat of history. You're right. People had to do it daily or else their food would rot.
That's exactly right.
Good point. Excellent.
Yeah.
So there was plenty of business.
Well,
to be
and
done.
You see, years ago also, after all, now you have eggs that are prepared a special way. Well, years ago, you had no way of keeping your eggs very long, unless you used what we called water glass. Water glass was a liquid which you purchased in a store. It came by the quart. You packed your eggs into a crock, small side down, and then poured this water glass over it, which was a matter of this mixture plus water. And that created like a film over your eggs to seal your eggs. So when you needed an egg, you went out to your crock and picked an egg out.
I'll be darned.
You see, all of these changes have come.
And you've certainly witnessed a lot.
I've witnessed all of that, you know.
Would you mind giving me your birth date?
No, July the 2nd.
What year?
1902.
1902. So you've certainly seen a lot in this century.
Yeah, that's
Wright
right.
Brothers to the moon.
Well, and of course, my father had a small store in Chicago.
Wow.
Right down on what is now Michigan Avenue, which is the Miracle.
Yeah, the Miracle Mile.
The Miracle Mile. Yeah, because we lived right down at the corner of Ohio and Lake Michigan in one of the big old houses there, one of the big old mansions, which we used as we rented rooms. Then my father had a building right adjacent to it where he had a small grocery store. And interesting enough, across the street, in the house right across the street, which was Charlie Mears lived over there.
I'll be darned.
Yeah, isn't that
That's
strange?
Incredible. Yeah.
Yeah.
Small world.
Really, yeah.
I'm not sure the date of this. I'm going to ask you the question, though, and I don't know the date. I just remember it was a horrific event. Maybe you can inform me. The Union picnics that used to be held in Chicago every summer are on Memorial Day. And one of the boats rolled over and 1,500 people...
Oh, wait a minute.
It was the worst maritime disaster in American history.
Mm-hmm.
And it happened in Chicago. Do you have any recollection?
Well, my God, of course, you see, we lived.
Right on the
water. Wait a minute, see, we lived, all right, if we would walk one block, we would be on Rush Street. And Rush Street was where the bridge that went across the Chicago River. So maybe four blocks that we would have to go. So we heard, of course, about this immediately. Wait a minute, this would have been about 1915.
That's the date I have, approximately 12 to 15.
This is the date I wanted, because you said it was either, because I was going to say I might have been 15 years old, you know. But I can remember running down there and standing on that bridge, because of course you see, that was the bridge that swiveled around, the old Rush Street Bridge.
Okay.
So we stood there on that bridge watching those people being rescued from that water.
That must have really hit you at your age.
No, you did. I'll never forget it. I'll never forget it, because you knew afterwards. Would be like if you'd have seen the Zeppelin.
Yeah, the Hindenburg go down or something.
Yeah, right offhand, I don't remember the name of that boat, but I will. It'll come. In fact, I know somewhere in my stuff I've got that all written down.
And so you sat there most of the day and watched.
just hoping they were going to find one more person alive.
What was the mood of the crowd? Was there a weeping?
Terrible. It was awful. But you see, it was a matter, there were too many people got on the one side of that boat.
And it just rolled it over. Yeah, I think there were 1,200 drowned right on
yeah,
the side.
Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm.
Lord, and that will be some memory that I guess you will always keep with you. Well, Edna, thank you very much for your time today.
Okay, well, if we haven't covered the waterfront, we'll do it some other time.
Oh, the waterfront of...
I'm only using that as a...
Okay, yeah, we'll get back together.
As an expression.
Think of anything, just write them down and then give me a call and we can go over this again.
Yeah.
You know, There's no reason we have to do it all at one time because memories don't work.
No, because after all, this is lots of work to.
Yeah, it's a lot of memories.
Yeah, that's right. Have you got anyone that can help you?
Not yet, but I'm just going to keep, you know, like most things, I'm going to bow my head down and keep going, and a job will get done. So.
You know, I'm just thinking about Dwayne Pearson. Oh, it seemed to me Dwayne would be, if Dwayne could help you. I don't know, I'm thinking off the top of my head.
You mean
he seems like such a good organizer.
He is.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
He is. I think the main problem that I have right now, I better turn this off, we're talking. I think the main help I need is to go.
And say the little red light is still on.